beyond myself when this kidnapping idea struck us. There was a town down there called Summit. We selected for our victim the only child of a prominent citizen named Ebenezer Dawson. The kid was a boy of 10 with bas relief freckles and red hair. The kid was in the street throwing rocks at a kitten on the fence when we drove in a car past Dawson's house. "Would you like to have a nice ride?" says Bill. The boy catches Bill nearly in the eye with a piece of brick. That boy put up a fight like a welterweight bear. But at last, we got him down in the bottom of the car and drove away. About 2 miles from Summit was a little mountain. On the rear elevation of this mountain was a cave. There we stored provisions. I went up on the peak of the little mountain and ran my eye over the vicinity. After dark, I went down the mountain. That boy was really scared me when he points Bill's gun at me. Luckily, it was not loaded. Bill says they're playing Indian. He is old Hank, the trapper, Red Chief's captive, and he is to be scalped at daybreak. The Red Chief immediately received me snake eye and announced that I was to be broiled at the stake at the rising of the sun. Yeah, that boy seemed to forget that he was a captive. Then we had supper. The Red Chief made a during dinner speech, something like this: "I had to go to school. I don't like girls. A parrot can talk, but a monkey or a fish can't. My father has lots of money." Every few minutes, he would remember that he was a pesky redskin and tiptoe to the mouth of the cave to rubber for the scouts of the hated paleface. Now and then, he would let out a war whoop that made old Hank the trapper shiver. That boy had been terrorized from the start. "Would you like to go home?" says I to the kid. "Oh, what for?" says he. "I don't have any fun at home. You won't take me back home again, will you?" "We'll stay here in the cave a while," says I. "All right," says he. We went to bed about 11 o'clock. We went afraid he'd run away. I was awakened by a series of awful screams from Bill. They weren't howls or whoops. They were simply indecent, terrifying screams, such as women emit when they see ghosts or caterpillars. Red Chief was sitting on Bill's chest, and he was realistically trying to take Bill's scalp. I got the knife away from the kid and made him lie down again. But from that moment, Bill's spirit was broken. I dozed off for a while, but I remember that Red Chief had said I was to be burned at the stake at the rising of the sun. I wasn't nervous or afraid, but I sat up. Later, I went up on the top of this mountain and reconnoitered. Bill and the chief cooked breakfast. Suddenly, the boy put a red hot boiled potato down Bill's back and then mashed it with his hand. Bill boxed his ears and the boy threatening to smash him with a rock as big as a coconut. But I took the rock away from the boy. The kid says to Bill that will fix him. After breakfast, the kid goes outside the cave. "What's he up to now?" says Bill anxiously. Just then, we heard something. I dodged and heard a heavy thud. I got paper and pencil and worked on the letter to old Dorset, demanding the ransom. I caught that boy. If you don't behave, says I, I'll take you straight home. I made him and Bill shake hands and drove away to send a letter to Dorset. Kid was tired of playing Indian. He wants to be the Black Scout and have to ride to the stockade to warn the settlers that the Indians are coming. How can I ride to the stockade without a horse? Bill gets down on his all fours and asks Kid how far is it to the stockade. 90 miles, says the Black Scout. Bill was rode the 90 miles to the stockade, not bearing an inch. Then, when the settlers was rescued, horse was given oats. Sand ain't a palatable substitute. Bill takes the boy by the neck of his clothes, showed him the road to Summit, and have sent him home. Then walked back to the cave. When I got back to the cave, Bill told me that boy gone home. Bill was sick and tired of the kid, and now we lose the ransom. There isn't any heart disease in your family, is there? Says I. Then you might turn around. Bill turns and sees the boy. I was afraid of his mind, and then I told him that tonight we would get the ransom and be all with it. In my letter to old Dorset, I demanded the money to be left in the box under the big rock close to the road about a couple miles from town. If a gang of constables should be watching for anyone to come for the ransom, I could see them. I waited an hour and then got the box. I opened the box, but inside was note, and I read it to Bill. It was written, "You bring Johnny home and pay me $500 in cash. You had better come at night, and I couldn't be responsible for what the neighbors would do to anybody they saw bringing him back." I was really angry, but I glanced at Bill and hesitated. "Sam," says he, "one more night of this kid will send me to a bed in the madhouse. You ain't going to let the chance go, are you?" So I agreed. We took him home that night. We got him to go by telling him that his father had bought a real machine gun for him, and we were going to get it back to the camp. We knocked at the front door. And I was counting out $500 into Dorset's hand. When the kid found out we were going to leave him at home, he started up a howl and fastened himself as tight as a leech to Bill. And as dark as it was, and as fat as Bill was, and as good a runner as I am, he was a good mile and a half out of Summit before I could catch up with him.